May I now invite Shri Arvind Kumar, IAS, Principal Secretary, Department of Municipal Administration and Urban Development, Government of Telangana, and in charge Vice Chancellor, Usmania University, to the podium for presidential address.
Dignitaries on the dais and dear friends, I'll rather confine myself to the subject I'm dealing with right now, that is, I look after municipal administration. So I'll try and cover some of the aspects pertaining to today's subject and how, in whatever little manner, we are trying to do it in an institutionalized manner. Just to give you a brief background, Telangana is among the more urbanized states in the country, historically so. Hyderabad is among the five top metros, and we have about roughly 45% of the population in the state is urbanized. just to put things in perspective, most of the southern Indian states, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, are urbanized. They all have 40% plus urban population. Last year, some of the bigger gram panchayats, because of certain features which are towards urbanization, things like what percentage of income is earned through non-agriculture activities, density of population, etc., etc. Last year about 68 new urban local bodies were created, and today in the state we have 141 urban local bodies, including Hyderabad. It also has, among these 141, 13 municipal corporations. The state also has created new districts. We have a total of 33 districts. And if you look at it district-wise, there are two districts, Rangareddy district, which is around Hyderabad. It has 15 urban local bodies. And Mechel, Malkadgiri, again, abutting Hyderabad, it has 13. There are 27 districts which have 5 urban local bodies or less, and there are 4 which are around 8 or so. So that's just to kind of give you a brief of where we are. We also had our assembly session concluded last week, 22nd, where the new municipal act was passed by the assembly. It's called Telangana Municipalities Act 2019. And it's not adding few amendments to the existing act, which was of 1965. We thought because of changed circumstances, we need to provide new sections. And I'll briefly read some of the sections which have relevance to today's topic. I'll start by reading section 24, which says that there shall be a municipality-wise green action plan. What it entails? Firstly, 10% of the budget, annual budget, will be a charged expense on creating greenery in the municipality. It's for the first time we are saying there are 5 items under charged expenses, things like payment of electricity bills, water bills. Among them, one of them is green cover in the municipality. 10% of the annual budget shall be earmarked for creating green budget. There shall be a district level committee headed by district collector and consisting of district forest officer who looks after social forestry and respective commissioners. They shall draw up a municipality wise green action plan year wise for every 5 years. So it's kind of rolling thing, which, depending upon the specific location and specific areas which are available for every ward and every municipality, shall clearly specify the likely number of plants, their species, depending upon the topography, etc., etc., for each of the municipality. The cost of maintain, each municipality shall also maintain at least one nursery and more, and the cost shall be maintained, shall be met from the green budget earmarked in the municipality budget. The chairperson, mayor and commissioner shall be responsible for setting up of the nursery. The commissioner shall designate special officer ward-wise who shall be in charge of ensuring the green cover and survival of these saplings. And all the officers as well as elected body members shall ensure 85% survival of the plants. Now, this is, while it's on paper as on today, we already had 2-day workshop with all the municipal commissioners, and government is giving a lot of emphasis to ensure that we achieve this in a big way, and then it goes in a very institutionalized manner in all the urban local bodies. I also would like to point out few more sections. Section 115, it talks about conduct of water audit in all the urban local bodies. Again, it's for the first time. The Act says, and I read, the municipality shall conduct water audit within its jurisdiction and make all efforts to reduce the non-revenue water, NRW. By the way, the extent of NRW seriousness can be gauged by the fact that in Hyderabad, where the total requirement is more than about, the wastewater which is generated is around 2000 MLD. We have 40% of the drinking water in Hyderabad is NRW. That's the kind of, which means if we can bring it down to less than 10%, it implies creating additional capacity of 30% in Hyderabad city alone. It's not something which is inachievable. ADB had taken up the study in Dhaka, and a city like Dhaka today, NRW is less than 10%. It again used to be in the range of 37-38%. So we are saying that every municipality shall conduct water audit to bring down the non-revenue water and may further initiate all necessary steps to rationalize usage of drinking water by ensuring the availability of recycled water for non-potable purposes such as horticulture, construction and other such activities as prescribed. B. Maintain complete survey maps, drawings and descriptions of water supply, main supply pipes and connections thereto from all premises in the municipal area. This is primarily to prevent the NRW. Again, we are institutionalizing the mechanism of how do we maintain our water. So far as drains are concerned, Hyderabad, you have seen yesterday, day before yesterday, we had 30 centimeters of rain. In the recorded history of Hyderabad, I think in September, this is the highest ever rainfall if we take from September 1st. So any amount of whatever infrastructure was there, it would have not been able to take care of this kind of thing. I am not defending that Hyderabad infrastructure is the best. The Act also says, Section 122, that municipalities shall, 122B, prepare a map for drains, stormwater drains, and sewerage network in its jurisdiction, capturing all existing facilities, missing gaps, and additional requirements therein, and give importance to all missing gaps and additional requirements for their improvements while preparing annual action plan for the municipality. Then prepare an annual action plan and maintain the upkeep of all drains and provide missing links wherever it's existing. So far as sanitation is concerned, Section 122, the municipality shall prepare a city sanitation plan, which inter alia shall include ward-wise and municipality-wise action plan for collection, segregation, transfer and processing of waste in a manner that 100% solid waste is lifted and disposed of on a daily basis. There are other sections, how we have defined how do we collect, segregate, etc., management of dump yards. By the way, Hyderabad generates about 5,800 to 6,000 metric tons of garbage per day. And I am happy to announce that we are processing entire 100% of it. It's done in a manner, composting, waste to energy through RDF. Right now, 19.8 megawatt of plant is being done by Ramki. It shall be operational from December this year. We have already applied to Ministry of Environment to increase the capacity to 48 megawatt, and that will take care of the entire RDF which is being generated on a daily basis. And the third is construction and demolition waste management. That also is being taken care of in Hyderabad. we are going to have a state level waste management board. Either it will be under Director of Municipal Administration or it will be a standalone body, but a specialized waste management board which shall handhold all the municipalities. We don't have the wherewithal to kind of deal on this technical issue, and we'll also arrange for possible fundings, whether waste management should be taken up on a cluster basis, municipality basis, what's the minimum kind of threshold level. So this waste management board shall take care of this issue. It's provided under the Act. We have deliberately kept it because we are at individual municipality level, we have been struggling how to deal with it. Couple of more that we have provided for what is called integrated township development based on walk to work concept. We are talking about encouraging townships which are self-contained, so it has a workplace, it has residence, schools, hospitals, commercial places in the same place. Minimum size will be 100 acres, and state shall be providing incentives to encourage such townships. The idea is to bring down traffic on the road and encourage people on walk to work, live a healthy lifestyle. I'm happy to announce that we already have about 5 to 7 live queries on this, and again it will go a long way in terms of reducing the traffic congestion, etc. Some of the things we are providing while according building permissions for individual buildings and layouts, section 176, it says, among other things, earlier also septic provision was there, but now we are saying all buildings of all sizes shall have an on-site treatment, which is either existing to the underground drainage, among others, shall also have fecal sludge management, fecal sludge and septage. We tried it out in Warangal. What's happening right now is the all the fecal sludge which is taken out from septic tanks is just taken in those big size vans and they are just disposed of in the drains. It's, I think, one of the biggest damages municipalities as a body is doing to the environment. And Warangal, we have tried it out. 69 other municipalities, now we are setting up fecal sludge and septage management. Telangana is among the first states to have taken up fecal sludge and septage in a very, very institutionalized manner. And this will go a long way in kind of improving the environment. I'm also happy to announce that we are making it mandatory that Energy Conservation Building Code, ECBC, or any other green building code as deemed appropriate, shall be made applicable to buildings as prescribed on plot above certain size or built up area beyond certain areas. Right now what we are doing is any structure which is more than 2000 square meters of built up area or plot size of 1000 square meters and above necessarily shall have ECBC compliance. We are also coming out with a new township, green township called Kokapet. It's spread over an area of about 150 acres. And with the recent auctions, if we include that also, it's an area of about 300 acres. There will be more than 500,000 people operating from this area. We have decided that the entire Kokapet township shall be a green township. So in terms of energy conservation code, which implies water saving, which implies energy saving, the entire township will be there. We are also now in the Act, we have provided that all parking places except individual houses shall be provided with electric vehicle charging infrastructure in their parking area. So these are some of the features I thought we should, we are now introducing in all the municipalities. In addition, we are also coming out with master plan for all the urban local bodies. Warangal is being launched on October 5th.
Recycle and reuse and really rejuvenate nature by water. ये सिक्स आपके इंडिया में, जबकि दुनिया में केवल 3 आ रहे हैं पानी के बारे में. यदि वाटर मैनेजमेंट करना हो तो फिर इंडिया में जो हमारी आप जानते हैं 90 एग्रो इकोलॉजिकल क्लाइमेटिक जोन में, सारी क्लाइमेटिक जोन में अलग अलग तरह से पानी का प्रबंधन करना होगा. इसलिए जहां 100 परिवार रहते थे वहां इस तरह की बावड़ी बनती थी, जहां 2 परिवार रहते थे वहां कुइयां बनती थी, और ये जो पानी का काम है ये केवल सरफेस के ऊपर, इंडिपेंडेंस के बाद हमने केवल सरफेस के पानी का मैनेजमेंट किया डैम बनाकर। इंडिया में बिफोर इंडिपेंडेंस धरती के पेट में कैसा रिजर्व बैंक है उसको हम कैसे पानी से भर के रख सकते हैं जिससे हमारे 10 फीट पे कुएं में पानी आता रहे। और वो जो डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड सप्लाई सिस्टम था विदाउट करप्शन विदाउट पॉल्यूशन, वो सिस्टम को इन्होंने हजारों साल इसलिए रखा कि वो धरती के अंदर के एक्वीफर्स को अच्छे से समझते थे। और ये जो एक्वीफर्स थे ये सब जगह अपना अपना अलग अलग तरह का हिसाब इनका था और इसको गांव के अनपढ़ लोग जानते थे। आप देख सकते हैं मेरी एक छोटी सी नदी है अरवली, उसमें 6 टाइप के एक्वीफर थे। इन सारे के सारे एक्वीफर के लेवल डिफरेंट होते हैं, डीप और सरफेस। तो इसको जब तक मैनेजमेंट रखा, ये जहां भी स्टीप स्लोप है वहां कॉन्वेक्स डिजाइन, जहां जेंटल स्लोप है और नेचुरल डैम है वहां ये। तो हमें यदि पानी का काम करना है, मैनेजमेंट करना है, इस इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस को यदि रियल में मैनेजमेंट और हमें क्लाइमेट चेंज समझना है, तो फिर इंडिजिनस नॉलेज सिस्टम से हम कैसे एंटरप्रेन्योर को आगे ला सकते हैं, कैसे रोजगार दे सकते हैं। ये जो एजुकेशन है ना ये केवल मेंटल एक्सरसाइज कराती है। जो इंडिजिनस नॉलेज सिस्टम है जब तक आपके रिश्ते उसके साथ नहीं होंगे तब तक आप मेंटल एक्सरसाइज करके ऊपर जा सकते हैं, लेकिन अपनी धरती क्लाइमेट और सस्टेनेबिलिटी के सवाल पे आप नहीं सोच सकते। यदि आपको सस्टेनेबिलिटी के सवाल पे सोचना है तो फिर देखना होगा, हमने कुल 11,800 डैम बनाए जिसमें से 2,500,000 कुएं रिचार्ज हुए। और 2,500,000 कुएं रिचार्ज होने का मतलब ये कि जो भी लोग शहर में चले गए थे गांव छोड़ के वो वापस कुएं में आए और खेती करने लगे। ये है क्लाइमेट चेंज अडेप्टेशन। और क्लाइमेट चेंज मिटिगेशन क्या है कि जो खेती कर रहे हैं उस खेती में कैसे जंगल को बचा के रख सकते हैं। और ये जो जंगल को बचा के रखने का सिस्टम है ये मैं छोड़ देता हूँ, बस जल्दी से एक चीज दिखाना चाहता हूँ। हिंदुस्तान में 90% पानी खेती में खर्च होता है और हमारा इस वक्त फार्मर ये नहीं जानता कि क्रॉप रेन कब आएगा, रेन पैटर्न को बिल्कुल नहीं जानता, रेन की इंटेंसिटी को नहीं जानता। पुराने जमाने में 40 साल पहले तक इंडियन फार्मर रेन्स को अज्यूम कर लेता था और उसका जो इंटरलिंक था वर्षा का और फसल का उसको वो करना जानता था। इसलिए तब तक हम हार्वेस्टिंग में इतना पानी यूज नहीं करते थे। आज हमें सीड सोइंग से लेकर हार्वेस्टिंग तक सारा धरती से पानी निकालना पड़ता है। तो यदि उसके मैनेजमेंट पे आपको कॉन्फिडेंस करनी है तो फिर इंडिजिनस नॉलेज सिस्टम में जो 90 एग्रो इकोलॉजिकल क्लाइमेटिक जोन है उनकी डायवर्सिटी को समझना होगा और फिर समझना होगा कि हिंदुस्तान के लोग अपनी क्लाइमेटोलॉजी को कैसे जानते समझते हैं। इन्होंने जब ये पानी का काम किया ये नदी सूख गई और इस नदी को जिंदा किया। इसमें तो साइंस है विद साइंस है। जब भी इंडियन लोग अपनी साइंस को विद साइंस यूज करते हैं तो वो ह्यूमैनिटी और नेचर दोनों का इक्वल रिस्पेक्ट करते हैं। और जब हम अपनी साइंस को केवल कैलकुलेशन इक्वेशन कॉन्सेप्चुअल मॉडल में डाल के करते हैं तो सारे काम मोस्टली एंटी नेचर और एंटी ह्यूमैनिटी होते हैं। इन लोगों ने कुछ नहीं किया, इन लोगों ने केवल नेचर के साथ रिस्पेक्ट करके स्ट्रक्चर बनाई और उससे पानी जहां दौड़ के चलता था वो वॉक करने लगा तो फिर अंडरग्राउंड एक्वीफर में चला गया। जब पानी अंडरग्राउंड एक्वीफर में जाता है तो सूरज चोरी नहीं कर सकता। हिंदुस्तान में आजादी के बाद एक इंजीनियर ऐसा नहीं है वो बता दे मुझे जिसने सूरज को चोरी करने से रोका हो। हिंदुस्तान में सबसे बड़ी चोरी करता है सूरज और सबसे हिंदुस्तान को पानी पिलाता है सूरज, लेकिन उसको राजस्थान जैसी जगह में चोरी नहीं करने देना चाहिए, उसको बंबई भेजना चाहिए चोरी के लिए। तो हमने सूरज को बंबई भेजा चोरी के लिए। ये नदी सूखी थी, ये मरी थी, अभी बहने लगी। ये नदी का उद्गम है वो पहाड़ी है, बस बदल गई। ये मेरा टीचर है अनपढ़ किसान और मेरी 2 दिन में उसने 2 डॉक्टरेट पूरी की ख्वाजा साहब। 1 दिन में मेरी डॉक्टरेट की, सूखे कुएं थे 25 उसमें नीचे डाल दिया और पूछा मुझे निकाल के तेरे इस कुएं में काई देखा रहे। पहले कुएं में कंफाइंड वर्टिकल फ्रैक्चर्स थे, दूसरे में हॉरिजॉन्टल फ्रैक्चर थे। तो जहां जैसे फ्रैक्चर हैं उन फ्रैक्चर्स को समझ के पानी रोकने का काम सिखाया। इसलिए ये जब ये 2 साल पहले गुजर गए, गुजरने से पहले एक गीत गाते थे, इसका गीत का मतलब समझ लो। मैं 2 बार नहाता था, अब 2 बार नहाता हूं। पहले मैं होली और दिवाली के दिन नहाता था, अभी मैं रोजाना 2 बार नहाता हूं। आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज द इंपैक्ट ऑन योर जीडीपी, आई नो द इंपैक्ट ऑफ द हैप्पीनेस ऑफ माय टीचर। जब उसको जिंदगी में रोजाना 2 बार नहाने की अपॉर्चुनिटी मिली तो उसके जीवन का आनंद कैसे हुआ वो ही जानता है या मैं जानता हूं। इसलिए हमें केवल सारी चीजें इकोनॉमी के इर्द-गिर्द देख के नहीं करनी चाहिए, जरा जरा और दूसरी चीजों को भी देखने की जरूरत है। ये वही गांव है, अब पहले जयपुर के सेठ इनको रोजगार देते थे, अभी ये जयपुर के सेठों को रोजगार देते हैं। आगे जल्दी नहीं चल रहा है, मैं जल्दी से आगे लेके जाना चाहता हूँ। देखो तुम्हें जब बुखार चढ़ता है तो तुम क्या करते हो, दवाई खाते हो ना, फिर पानी की पट्टी रखते हो और फिर आराम करते हो। ठीक, ग्लोबल वार्मिंग और क्लाइमेट चेंज में भी 3 काम करने की जरूरत है। सबसे पहले धरती पर पानी की पट्टी रखनी है, जहां जहां चार डैम बना के पानी को रिचार्ज करना। और दूसरा, धरती की दवाई है हरियाली, जहां हरियाली बढ़ती है वहां अपने आप क्लाइमेट अडेप्टेशन और मिटिगेशन दोनों काम हो जाते हैं। उसके लिए कुछ अलग से करने की जरूरत नहीं है। मैं बस 1 मिनट में खत्म कर रहा हूँ, ये तो हमारी पार्लियामेंट है, इसको छोड़ देते हैं, नहीं बताते। देखो यहां से सनलाइट आती है, ये जो रेड लाइट है इसके अंदर कोई गैस नहीं होती। ये रेड लाइट जब हमारे अरेबियन सी पे पड़ती थी तब अरेबियन सी को जो भी खारा पानी था उसको डिसैलिनेट करके ब्लू हीट में चेंज कर देती थी। तो अब गैस आ गई इसमें H2O, रेड हीट ब्लू हीट में चेंज हुई। ये जो रेड हीट है ये इस तरफ जाती है हरियाली की तरफ, क्यों जाती है, क्योंकि वहां प्रेशर कम होता है। और जैसे ही ब्लू हीट ग्रीन हीट के ऊपर आती है वैसे ही दोनों का पानी और गर्मी डिस्चार्ज हो जाते हैं, बारिश हो जाती है। लेकिन ये जो इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन की रेड हीट है, ये मैनमेड रेड हीट है, ये बड़ी खतरनाक है। मेरा इलाका पूरा यहाँ था तो रेनसेट और रीजन था, बारिश नहीं होती थी। हम लोगों ने इस इलाके में 11,800 स्ट्रक्चर बनाए, बारिश नहीं आई। फिर हमने क्या किया, ये जो फादर साहब का जो सरिस्का का टाइगर प्रोजेक्ट का पानी था वो हमारी 600 वाटर बॉडीज में आके उसको पेरिनियल बना गया। पेरिनियल बनते के साथ ये माइक्रो क्लाउड फॉर्मेशन हुआ। इस माइक्रो क्लाउड फॉर्मेशन ने मैक्रो क्लाउड्स को बुला लिया। माइक्रो क्लाउड फॉर्मेशन माइक्रो क्लाउड आके नहीं बन सकते, तो बारिश होने लगे। ये आखिरी स्लाइड है। यदि क्लाइमेट चेंज की सस्टेनेबिलिटी पर बात करनी है इस इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस में तो ये समझना होगा कि कुएं विचार होने से जो धरती का एलिडो, अंदर का एलिडो इंपैक्ट है, ग्रीनरी जब अपने आप आएगी, रिवर्स माइग्रेशन होगा, खेती में लोग जाके काम करेंगे, तो ये परिवर्तन अपने आप शुरू हो जाएगा। और ये मिटिगेशन जो जब कार्बन का सेक्वेस्ट्रेशन का लेवल हाई होगा तो आपका इकोसिस्टम भी ठीक होगा और आपकी इकोलॉजी भी ठीक होगी और उसकी सस्टेनेबिलिटी अपने सिस्टम में इनबिल्ट होकर हमें आगे का रास्ता दिखा सकेगी। थैंक यू दुबे साहब, मिश्रा जी और बट मैं यही कहना चाहता था कि यदि आप सचमुच क्लाइमेट की चिंता करते हैं तो क्लाइमेट चेंज और ग्लोबल वार्मिंग ग्लोबल थ्रेट है, लेकिन सॉल्यूशन लोकल है। और सॉल्यूशन केवल एजुकेशन में नहीं है, सॉल्यूशन विजडम में और इंडिजिनस नॉलेज सिस्टम में टाइम टेस्टेड में है। 2015 से पहले भारत सरकार और यूएन क्लाइमेट चेंज में पानी को शामिल नहीं करती थी। हमने पेरिस में जाकर 40 दिन तक आंदोलन किया, 40,000 लोग थे हम दुनिया से। उसके बाद वाटर इज क्लाइमेट एंड क्लाइमेट इज वाटर स्लोगन आपके पेरिस एग्रीमेंट में भी और एसडीजी में भी आ गया। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
Thank you so very much, sir, for reiterating the fact that not only education, it also has to be indigenous knowledge, which is essential for overcoming the facts. May I now request Sri Sandeep Chachar, Executive Director, ActionAid, New Delhi, to deliver the keynote address.
We are very honored to be partnering this, to be with you, Professor Mishra, and the initiative of our IPE on this fund. For ActionAid, this is a very natural partnership, so I want to say that. So thank you, and I'll be really quick. Sorry, I feel embarrassed with those very nice words. Thank you. One needs to say that it's a very crucial time when we are having this debate. We've just ended the climate summit globally. You know how PETA was bearing the leadership of the world. Sir, you raised that. I think there are four key questions that I would like to raise, because we are in the assembly of August academicians, people who have been practitioners, those who have worked immensely on the questions of water. Rajan Singhji is here. It's been a great inspiration for several of us. The first of those questions, in a very abbreviated manner in the 5 minutes that I have, is the question of who has access and control over water and who hasn't. In some ways, this question is fundamental. It's not a new question. It's a cumulative historical question which is still alive and unresolved in this century and needs definitely to be investigated and resolved in this century. And this question mirrors the divides that we have in our societies. So women would have to walk to the moon and back in order to fetch water. That's the cumulative numbers. Yeah. Dalits don't, our own study on untouchability, ActionAid study, I worked with ActionAid, study on in 2002, and now we've just finished another round of reinvestigating the same nature, extent and forms of untouchability, will still tell us Dalits don't get access to water. Coastal fisherfolk are given to rebelling and given to sort of all kind of movements simply because they think their coast and their sea. But it isn't the case. Trawlers have taken that over. So in some ways, there's a big question on the issue of who has water, who doesn't, who controls water, who doesn't, who has the right to water, and who doesn't have the right to water. I think this is a fundamental historical and unresolved question of our times. The second of these, and a lot more attention needs to be given to this dynamic. The second of these is the question which Dr. Anupama in the morning has raised, and thanks for raising it, is the question of the quality and where water is available and where it isn't. It's a second key question here. It's not just that pollution and polluted waters are killing life forms, whether be it marine life or whether be it plants, but it's also killing us. So in some ways, the question of quality of water has, in a sense, been an evolutionary question. It's a new question. It isn't a historical question. It hasn't been there last 300 years. So it's something which is of an evolution, which I think hits us most. And you can see what is happening in Punjab. We use chemical fertilizers, and the result of it through the linkage of water is cancer drains. So in some ways, the question of quality of water and how we look at questions of resolving the quality of water and water availabilities in particular areas and unavailabilities in particular areas and over-availabilities in particular areas. Arvind sir was giving a recent sort of example of rains in Hyderabad. I mean, cities aren't really prepared, and there's little you can do. Kerala wasn't prepared for the floods and so on. So I think that's the second unresolved question one would, in a sense, like to flag off. The third, of course, is the question of governance of water. And so I'm not only referring to groundwater policy here. In fact, Rajendraji and myself got together in 2016. We were doing a Padyatra in Marathwada, Rajendra, you might remember. And what did we see there? So we saw sugarcane farms, flourishing sugarcane farms. This is the drought of Marathwada in 2016. And we saw drought conditions everywhere else. So somebody was using groundwater immensely and somebody else wasn't using. But this is no longer just a national question. This has also international implications. So you can't have Nero's fiddling when Amazon is burning or Congo is burning, because it has international implications. I think in the beginning you said it's not just a national question, but also a national, international question. Lastly, I think I would like to say and reiterate the fundamental unresolved question of our time, and that is the whole issue of ecology per se, the whole issue of the world that we have built. What kind of nature and commons do we foresee for our future? We have a world built on competition. We need to move to a world built on cooperation and solidarity. And that's what tribals teach us. So the path going ahead is to rebuild the commons of humankind. Sorry for being rushed, and thank you so much. And I would hand over the mic to Mr. Peter.
So thank you so much. I think two very important things have come. What our watermen of the country, what told us that we should understand the nature and dynamics of watermen. We have failed to do that. We have superimposed the modern approach. We just can't work for a country like ours. And so I fully agree with you. And I have also suggested that we must look into the indigenous ways, you know, how we are doing, how is Bikaner, how Bikaner does it, how Jaisalmer does it, how other parts we do. So I think sacrifice and Amitabh is there. In our proposal, I think we have to bring in a big way, I think, rather how we can have a solution to this problem. Can we have a solution to this problem by the current kind of education approaches, or can we also understand how we are doing it earlier and how we can benefit from that? So that's one thing. And Sandeep ji, I think you made a tremendous contribution in two things. Rights-based approach. Here it's not, I think, all of us have told this. Not money-based approach. Not power-based approach. You know, not, you know, the social power that you have. I think rights-based approach is the most important thing that you told. And I think governments, I think, and there are, I think, all of our panelists, they made a good, you know, observation that I think self-discipline is the best discipline. I think we think that solution will come from the government. And what is government, I think? We elect government, I think. We put them in power, I think. And those who administer also are people. So if you expect them to solve each and every problem, that's just not possible. It's we, I think, problems start, I think, we are problems originate at our level. And since they originate at our level, naturally, I think we have to solve them. Now with this, I think, I request Dr. Amukar, this human resource development book to our vice chancellor, I would say, not to hear them to chief, because human resource development will determine the fate of this country. If we can't develop our human resource well, I don't think it's going to make a big thing. And IIP is the first institute in India, vice chancellor said, IIP is the first institute in India which has come out with its own indigenous specialized human resource development. There is no IIM, no IIT, there is no organization in the country which has come out with its own case group. IIP has taken the lead, and my colleague who has done it now, I think group of Indian participants, they are leaving from India to work with the schools abroad. Watermen, you know, of our country, and we have done a book on water management. Certainly, we'll take advantage of the ideas that you have given, and we'll have another book on that. I request Anupma to get the book released on water management by We have the UGC, Joint Secretary here. IP has produced about 95 PhDs and we have now 25 fellowships. We want to have 100 fellowships at the institute. We are the first institute of the ICSA which have documented, you know, the findings of all the PhDs and the impact of those PhDs on public policy. We have traced that. I request Dr. Shakir Ahmed to read the book on social science research. Sandeep Chatterjee to please read the book on sustainable development. This is the project we have done with Metal Nation and based on that the book has been prepared. Thing which Rajendra Singh wanted Khwaja Sahab to do on Ganga. So I am reminded of Bhupen Hazarika, who is no more. And Bhupen Hazarika would can I request Khwaja Sahab to read the book? Please come forward and present a moment to Khwaja Sahab. I request Dr. Anupama to present a moment to Sandeep Khwaja Sahab.
May I now request Sri Biswajit Roy Chowdhury, Chairman SAIARD, to propose vote of thanks.
Thanks a lot and welcome to all of you in this IP conference. And as a Chairman of SAIARD, I am very happy to share this venue with this honorable dignitaries on the dais and also the participants in front of mine. So first of all, I would like to give my wonderful thanks to Dr. R.K. Mishra, sir, Director of IP, as well as our convener, ma'am, Dr. Anupama Dubey Mohantiji. And I am also thanks to all of the honorable dignitaries who came here and sitting there, sharing their valuable views with us regarding these conference issues. So, whatever the, as we going very short time, this time briefing 1-2 minutes, The triad is going to operate its activities through from February, and within a short span of time we have just expanded. We are working throughout India and basically on the capacity building activities and programs also. So within a short span of time we have already signed some MOU, and with the government organizations, universities are there with us, and even the corporate and industry house also. And there are several centers through which we are working on different academic issues, which are basically developed on the skill development or capacity buildings of the students. So lastly, I would like to conclude this session through the one and only, already the Professor Dr. Khaja sir, Arvind ji, Shakil Ahmed sir, Rajendra Singh ji, Sandeep Chachar sir already explained the key notes through their keynotes concept, what are the issues, what should we have to do with to protect our water resource management, and how to protect with our activities. And lastly, I would like to conclude with one line: if we want, we can. If we want, we can, to protect our nature, protect our water. Because these small initiatives is like just a small drops of water which can make a big ocean. Thanks a lot for being here, and on behalf of SIAD, on behalf of IP, I'd like to give a special thanks to you. Thanks a lot to all of you.
We cordially invite you to partake in the networking team, the Lush Green Lawn. Before that, we want you to gather here to take a group photograph to mark a memory for the conference.